guys, welcome to my channel. So recently I read this book, The Organized Mind by Daniel Levitin, and I found it very useful in terms of the tips to organize not only your mind, but also your daily life. So if you'd like to find more tips about making your life and mind more organized, stay tuned. So the first tip relates to multitasking and attention. What I learned from this book is the fact that our mind and attention are actually split into the central executive and also the mind wandering modes. The central executive mode is the one that helps us concentrate on a specific task. If, for example, you're preparing for an exam or you're writing an essay or working on a project, the central executive part of our attention is in charge of making sure that you're staying focused. We all know, of course, that multitasking or jumping from one task to another in a very short period of time can, of course, be bad for productivity. But even if you eliminate all the distractions, it still can sometimes be hard to actually stay focused on one specific task. And what I found actually useful as a tip to address this challenge is using a brain extender, as Daniel Levitin calls it. So a brain extender can just be a sheet of paper where if something comes to your mind that you think might be important, you can just write it down on a sheet of paper. And I think it's a very actually useful tip because oftentimes when we remember something while we're trying to also work on something else, it can just kind of stay in the back of our minds to make sure that we don't forget something important. But if you just really use a sheet of paper of your brain extender, just write it down, it really helps to actually stay more focused on something that you're currently doing. Daniel Levitin actually mentions the fundamental principle of organization, which is shifting the burden of organizing from our brains and putting it in the physical world. There's also the second part of our attention, which is the mind wandering mode, which is actually one of our natural or default state of mind. And oftentimes, of course, we try to fight it, right? We try to always be super focused, not necessarily letting the mind wander. But what this book actually argues is the mind wandering mode is actually very important because it is the driver of creativity. You might have probably experienced this when you went on a walk or in a run and you weren't necessarily listening to anything or thinking about anything specific. This is when your mind actually can come up with the most creative ideas or ways to address certain challenges. For example, if you're standing in the line or commuting and are just on your phone or listening to something, it can of course be also helpful and productive, but you do not actually give the space to your mind to just wander and provide the space for your mind's creativity. One of the tips that I found useful that even going on a short walk without really focusing on anything else or listening to anything else can be very helpful to come up with new ideas. The second tip that I found very useful is actually related to decision making. The book actually says that for non-priority, not the most important decisions, it is good enough to make, as he calls them, satisfying decisions, which is the decision related to just being good enough or satisfying you. If, for example, you're choosing where to meet up with your friends or what to eat for lunch or dinner, we might often overthink these decisions. But in reality, whether you choose option A or option B won't necessarily affect your sense of satisfaction. So you might as well just not waste time and energy on thinking too much about these non-priority decisions. The third tip that I found very useful is related to actually organizing our social world and how we think about people and the world in terms of categories. So our brain is just used to thinking in categories. It can of course be helpful if, for example, you're using categories for learning, but this kind of thinking also of course creates a lot of cognitive biases. Let's look at an example. Think of a person that you know really well, like your relative or your close friend or your partner. And now just stop this video and rate this person according to these options. Now just go back and do the same for yourself. So most people actually rate their friends or people that they know based on traits, the first two columns of the picture that we saw, and they rate themselves in terms of situations. So this just shows us the bias of how we think about people in terms of categories. And this happens because we often see a limited number of actions by people, and we definitely, of course, do not see the diversity of thoughts and feelings that they experience. Versus for us, of course, we experience all kinds of actions, public and private, and we also experience our different thoughts and feelings. So it is important to bear in mind that oftentimes when we think and kind of categorize people based on their traits, it might not necessarily be true. Another bias related to the social world is also related to categorization and thinking about people as in-groups and out-groups. In-groups are people or categories that we kind of relate to. For example, people from your country, if you're living abroad, people from your religion, your university, your workplace, versus, for example, people from another country, people of another religion, or rival university. diversity, and we tend to think of people from the in-group as a very diversified collective of different individuals, and for the out-groups we often tend to think of people as just a not diversified collective of the same individuals, which is of course not true. And this can of course lead to a lot of biases and of course a lot of issues like racism, political conflicts, social conflicts, religious conflicts, and so on. So the example that this book actually gives is if Democrats were asked to describe other Democrats in their group, they would just say, of course, that they are a very diversified collective, they're very different individuals, versus if they were asked to describe Republicans, they would just say that, well, those Republicans just think about lower taxes, they're all the same. And of course, that is not the right way of thinking. Of course, the out-group is just as much of a diversified collective of individuals as the in-group. So it is very important to be aware of this bias when we think about social categories. The next tip is related to procrastination, actually. Of course, I'm sure you've heard a lot of material about procrastination, but I found actually this book's framework very interesting because Daniel Levitin actually describes it as a formula. So the formula is procrastination is equal to time to complete the task times distractibility times delay, which is the amount of time one has to wait to receive positive feedback. And so the higher all of these three areas are, the higher there is a risk of procrastination. And then this numerator is divided by the denominator, which is self-confidence and task value. And I think it's actually a very good point about often associating our self-worth with a task that we're working on, which actually the higher this correlation, the more we procrastinate. We often might think, well, I'm writing this essay and if I fail it, it might affect my self-worth, so we delay working on this specific project or this essay. So it is important to bear in mind when working on important projects that they should not be correlated with your sense of self-worth, which is of course important not only from the procrastination perspective, but also in general related to your self-confidence and sense of self-worth as well. The next tip, or actually two tips, are related to the digital world. The first of these tips is related to password generation. I think that's one of my biggest pain points is when, for example, the corporate website or a company's website asks me to change my password every 2 months and I'm just running out of password ideas. I think I've used all the complicated passwords with 10 plus characters with different numbers, letter casing, and so on. And I often tend to forget what kind of complicated password I used for each specific website. So this tip is actually very useful to address this challenge. What this book suggests is taking a phrase, for example, let's take this phrase, my favorite TV show is Breaking Bad. The idea is to create a new password, you take this base phrase, you take the first letter of each word in this phrase, and then you combine them together. So this already gives you a complicated enough password idea. To create additional characters, you might, for example, change a letter S to a dollar sign. Now, this is your base password, and then you can think of the context for which you're using these passwords. Let's say you're using it for your Citibank checking account. Again, you can just take the first letters of each of these words and then add them in front of this set of strings. And then you get your complicated password. And the second tip in terms of the digital world and working remotely, which we often experience these days, what this book suggests is the most optimal solution to really staying focused on each task you're working on is having a separate gadget for your project. So for example, if you're working on your full-time job, it is the most optimal to use a separate laptop for just work versus having a different one for entertainment and other projects. But this of course can be very expensive, and so as an alternative and also a very efficient solution, this book actually suggests that you might just have two different workspaces to work on two different projects. So for example, if you have a full-time job and a side project, you might just use one table or one workspace in your apartment for your full-time job and then use another table or another workspace for your side project. And this change in your workspaces can significantly increase your productivity and efficiency. And now the bonus takeaway, which I think I found as one of the most interesting points in this book, is the power of the junk drawer, as this book calls it. So we all kind of have this junk drawer in our apartments where we just put everything, for example, some extra tape, some extra pens, some other things that don't necessarily fit into any other drawers. But sometimes it is important also to just get rid of these things to provide more space for something more useful. And then the author actually gives a very good comparison of this junk drawer with life. And I found his philosophy very interesting. So he's saying how just like in the junk drawer, in life, we might experience also unexpected loss, for example, of a friend, of a job, or the whole economy collapses. And so the best way to actually improve upon these brains that we have is just adjust to the situation and the new circumstances. And here is the quote that I like the most, which says, "My experience is that when I've lost something I thought was irreplaceable, it's usually replaced with something much better. The key to change is having faith that when we get rid of the old, something even more magnificent will take its place." And I think this is a very empowering quote because it just really provides you a perspective of not being afraid to make a change in your life, not only related to organizing your space or your daily schedule, but in general your life, and things that are just sometimes important to replace. This perspective and this mindset really gives you a lot of empowerment to do the necessary changes in your life. So that's pretty much it. I hope you found these tips useful. Let me know if you have any other tips that you find useful to organize your daily life and your mind. And thank you so much for watching, and I'll see you in the next video.